On today's episode, for once my gappy joinery is actually a good thing. Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by
MicroJig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
Detailed plans for the 8-drawer tall dresser featured in today's episode are available for sale in the digital download store at mattsbasementworkshop.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So as you can see, since the last video, we have done quite a bit of work here. Actually, it doesn't look that much different other than the fact that the top is in position, and we're gonna talk a little bit about that today. So if you were following along with the build videos as they were coming out, you probably are very aware that there's a bit of a gap between the last video and today's video, and that has more to do with the fact that it's spring, it's April as I'm recording this. That's a time when everything gets really busy outside, cleaning up the yard, and of course my birthday was in April, and we actually happened to have guests that came in, some foreign exchange students that were staying with us. So it was like the perfect storm of just getting in the way of not being able to come down and do very much. But once everything was cleared out and we were ready to go, we made the final progress, the final push on what we needed to take care of for the construction of the dresser itself. Now, when it comes to the finishing portion, we're gonna end up painting this. The biggest problem right now is trying to figure out what color it's gonna be painted. So more about that, probably in a blog post or something, but we're gonna go ahead and wrap up the build video with the discussion that we have today, which is gonna surround one, installing the top, and two, getting a really nice reveal all the way around these inset drawers. And we'll talk about that in just a second, because there was one or two other things about the drawers that I wanted to mention. But first, let's get right into it with the top here. Now, the top, we ended up milling this at the same time we did the sides, and so we had the panel sitting around for a little while. We thankfully, we didn't have any real issues with it, so we must have done the milling correctly. The only thing we needed that was left to do, of course, was to cut it to the right dimension. And it turned out that the depth and the length of the top itself really exceeded what I could do on my table saw very safely. Now, of course, I probably could have easily used some sort of crosscut sled. The one I have actually was too small for, of course, the depth on this tabletop. So I ended up turning to my track saw. So you could easily set up some sort of jig or something with a circular saw if you tried to go this route, if you don't have a track saw. But in my case, I happen to have one. So I went ahead and I set up my smaller centipede sawhorse that I have. Of course, you could use some just regular sawhorses, or even sometimes I'll work right off the top of my table saw. I got the first end all squared up for what I want to do, and I made my first pass with the track saw. Once that was done, I just quickly measured for the length that I wanted for the top here. And once I made a couple of marks, I put the track saw guide right on top of that, clamped it in position, and then made my second cut. Which now gave me a perfectly squared top. Actually, one more step. I kind of completely forgot about this, which was really stupid because, again, I ended up using just the track saw, or if you were using some sort of jig or something, you'd do the same thing. Since I had everything set up, rather than breaking it down and then getting the table saw all set up, not like that's difficult, I just simply took the track saw, and the track was long enough that I could rip it down to the width that I needed, and actually left a pretty decent cut. Of course, we'll be coming back in and doing some final sanding and everything on this. But we then had our panel for the top. So the only thing left to do with that then is to come in and attach it. And to attach it, what we ended up doing was, and you can see in the footage here, I ended up coming through and I went up through the frame, the very top frame here. And what I did was I came in on an angle, and I wanted to make sure that the angle that I had for the drill would be an angle so that when I went to drive the screw into position, I wouldn't be fussing around with it too much. So I'm basically just kind of setting myself up to make it a lot easier on myself. So once I did that on one side, I came back in, I did it on the other side, and I actually even did it here on both openings, or what would be the drawers here. I did one and there, one here. And these are going to help hold the top in position very nicely. Because of the fact that we need to be concerned about wood movement itself. And remember, it's going to move across the width of the board. So in this case, it's going to be during across the depth of the top. What I did was I kind of just came back in with the drill and I drove it down through the top, and you can see that I more or less just kind of wiggled it back and forth to elongate the hole. And what that will end up doing is, as I drove the screw into position, as you can see here, what that will do is, if there is any wood movement, it's just going to allow that screw to move back and forth with it, and I'm not going to have to worry as much about the possibility of it cracking and checking and all of those bad things. So that takes care of the top itself. It's in position, and like I said, we just need to do a little bit of touch up here, soften these edges, soften the corners, and it's all set to go. So now let's go ahead and take a closer look at the drawers themselves. So in the last episode, we did the drawer construction, and as you remember, we ended up putting in these pinned rabbets. So we ended up driving some dowels through the side of the side into the drawer front and just glued those in position and then made them nice and flush with the sides. And this does a really good job of making it very, very strong, very similar to the type of strength that you would get with a traditional dovetail or something. As you can see, and maybe you saw this much earlier on, and some I posted this like on Instagram and I think over at Facebook or something. One thing I ended up doing is when I moved to the much larger or the much longer bottom drawers, rather than following along with what I had already done up here, which is put in 2 3/8-inch dowels, I already knew that I wanted to add maybe 3 or 4 of them. And I was just thinking, I'm like, you know what, the spacing probably would work out perfectly fine with these 3/8-inch ones, but I really like the idea of maybe going smaller as I'm adding more of them onto the side. So this is a 1/4-inch dowel, and as you can see, there's 4 of them on each side, and I really like the look of it. In fact, I kind of wish that I'd have enough time to maybe go back and completely redo all of the tops. I'd end up having to make all new top drawers, but I really like the look of these. And sure, there's a part of my OCD-ish kind of mind that's freaking out that I have large dowels on top, small dowels on top, on the bottom. How's that going to work? But because of the fact that all 4 of the top drawers have the large dowels, you know, that whole pattern works fine. And again, I think this looks really good for these longer ones. So that's not a big deal. Anyway, so what we need to do now is to actually talk about the reveal, or maybe the shadow line. Maybe that's what you're more familiar with. It might be a term you're more familiar with that we're going to put on the drawer fronts here, because it's really important, number one, that when you are facing an inset drawer, you like to have, again, that those lines that reveal, that shadow line, look uniform all the way around as much as possible. And another important thing about this is it has a lot to do with wood expansion and contraction. So bear with me here just real quick. We're going to get right into this. But right now, as we're wrapping up this video, as we're constructing this, it's still very much kind of the colder months as we're heading into the warmer months. In fact, I'm wrapping this up in the end of April, and I know it's not going to be probably for another couple of months before I really have the type of humidity in the air that's going to cause these drawers to expand, especially in my own home. I have a really good idea of how bad these are going to potentially get. So as I am doing the reveal this time of year, I need to make sure that I make it potentially, for the lack of a better description, a little bit more gappy than I would expect. If I was building this in the height of the humid summer months, I would put it exactly where I want it, which typically is somewhere around 1/16 of an inch all the way around here. But because I know for a fact that these are still going to expand just slightly, not a lot, but just slightly, I'm going to make that just a little bit gappier. So probably a little bit 3/32 of an inch, probably a little bit just shy of 1/8 of an inch, something like that. But that will give me the absolute look that I want. And of course, makes it really easy for these to open and close when it does expand and contract, or when it expands in the summer months. So let's go ahead and we've got a couple more of these to do. In fact, these ones with the blue tape, these are all completed. So I have all of these other drawers to do, but I went ahead, I pulled out one of the smaller ones, and let's take a quick gander at how I end up putting on that reveal, and then we'll just go from there. So the reveal is really not that difficult with inset doors. Sometimes it almost seems like it's a little intimidating because of the fact that you're like, I need to make sure it's uniform all the way around. But the first step that I ended up taking to help me get into the position I'm in is when I was milling the drawer fronts themselves, especially when it came to cutting them to the final length that I needed. And I paid close attention to the opening itself. So I knew that it was a fixed position, and rather than making the drawer front so that it was snug inside that opening, once I knew what that final dimension was, I came in here and I measured this, and as I've said over and over, I like about a 16th of an inch reveal all the way around. So I ended up cutting this about close to an eighth of an inch shy. Of course, I wanted to make sure I had a little bit of wiggle room in there. And what we can end up doing is you'll see how we get the rest of the reveal put together, and you can kind of translate that for the sides. But I'm not going to do much with it on this one because I've got it exactly the position that I want it to be in, so I don't want to mess it up too much. Where I'm really going to be concentrating the most is on the top and the bottom. And of those two, I'm going to be concentrating quite a bit on the top, because if you really think about it, when the drawer is sitting in the opening, that bottom is kind of a fixed position. So if there's going to be any expansion and contraction, obviously it's going to be going across the width of the board, but there's not a lot we can do about the bottom because it's always going to be in contact with the drawer frame right here. So what we need to do is to try and compensate as much as possible here on the top. And this is where it potentially is going to look a little bit gappy. But anyways, let's go ahead and get started with this. And all I'm doing is I'm just coming in with my block plane, and I'm just going to do a couple of passes. I'm going to be careful, of course, on the side. I don't want to blow it out. So if necessary, I'll come in to make sure that it's okay. But we're just going to take a few passes here to get it where we want it. So let me do one more pass. And like I said, it's okay if this is kind of gappy. In fact, like I said, we kind of want it that way. So let's go ahead and let's put this into position here. And all right, so I'll try and bring the camera in here, and it has just a little bit of a ways to go. It's almost exactly there. In fact, the reveal that's there right now is just a pinch bigger than I would want it to be if it was at full contraction and the height of humidity. So that's telling me, all right, we're really, really close. So let's go ahead and we're gonna pull this back out, take that extra pass, and then as soon as I do, I'm gonna come back in and we're gonna work on the bottom. So it only took a couple of passes and we were all set with the top there. So now that, like I mentioned, we're gonna have that little bit more gappiness in there, let's go ahead and take care of the bottom here. And this one is gonna be really easy. We just gotta be careful here because I think now that I flipped it, the grain's gonna be running a little bit different. But really the bottom here, as I mentioned, is gonna be resting against that frame rail. So what I wanna do more than anything else is I just wanna kind of set a pseudo shadow line. So I will maybe hit just a little bit all the way across here just to clean it up a little bit because it's a little bit rough from the previous milling. But all I'm really going to do is kind of more or less just create a chamfer. That's all there really is to it. It's just creating a chamfer that will mimic that final reveal line here on the bottom. Because again, all of our expansion and contraction we're going to be worried about there on the top. So let's just go ahead and do that one really good pass on here to help clean up all of those mill marks. Oh yeah, that took care of it, good. And then we're just going to do a really, nothing more than a chamfer. And we're gonna double check ourselves here to make sure that we're not blowing past what we want. Another nice thing about this is it will actually help with avoiding some chipping effects potentially, I don't know, as you're moving it around or something, but let's go ahead and let's take a look at this. Let's get it in position. And all right, that's really, really got a little ways to go, but we're heading in the right direction. So let's go ahead and finish this up. Now, another thing you might have noticed as I was pushing this in, I kind of like hesitated for a second here. And that's another thing that's telling me that you know what, I need to take another pass or so, because as I feel this right here, where the side fits into this rabbet, it's kind of proud of it a little bit, the drawer front is. So it's actually, it's catching in a weird way on here as it's going through. So let me go ahead and knock that down. There, that should take care of it. There. All right, that will take care of it. And now, again, we'll just take a little bit heavier chamfer here. We'll sneak up on it. And, all right, that should be good. There we go. Oh yeah, that's exactly, let me get down low here. That's pretty much what we want. So that's how easy it is. Now, I did it with just the one, and as I mentioned, I'm not worried about the sides here. If it turned out that you needed to kind of give that reveal a little bit more on the sides, again, what we just did with the bottom, just that slight chamfering will give you that pseudo shadow line. Actually, it is a shadow line. It's not a pseudo shadow line. It is a shadow line. So I have just a small tweaking on this one, just something that just caught my eye. I'm going to go ahead and take care of it, but essentially we're going to continue doing that chamfer. And I have that left to do on all of the rest of these. And this then is completely constructed, and it's ready for the finishing, which is going to be the painting, which I don't know what color it's going to be. So anyways, though, that is pretty much all there is to it. All right, folks, so this is a really good place to stop today's episode and, of course, to more or less wrap up the entire tall dresser build. Of course, we do have some details that I have not been able to cover right now, and it's probably going to be a little while as I'm recording this to cover them, so please come back and check periodically at my website to see what we have going on with this. I'll make sure to post it on the social medias too, Facebook, Instagram, all that stuff. But we need to figure out, one, what color are we painting it, and two, what kind of knobs or pulls are we putting on this? I've got to get this information from my daughter, who has a very busy social life, so maybe one of these times when I'm driving her around, I can kind of maybe drive past a paint store or a pull and knob store or something and figure out if I can somehow get her in there to give me an answer so we can get this all wrapped up. But no guarantees coming anytime soon, which is good because I still have to sand this whole thing down, and the painting and the sanding and all that stuff probably will end up being something for the Wooby level patrons of Matt's Basement Workshop, but I will definitely let everybody know more about that as it comes out. So anyways, one thing I should mention real quick about the painting, this I was looking at this reveal, it made me think of it real quick. Because of the fact that I know that I'm painting this, and because of the fact that these drawers have yet to expand like they will in the humid, humid days of summer, that's another reason to make sure that this gap all around here is even that much bigger, because of the fact that I'm going to be putting a layer of paint on this edge, and I've got a layer of paint that's going to be going on that mating edge, which means that there's now just that much less room for expansion and contraction, not significantly, but enough. So that's another reason to make this as gappy as possible. But this drawer, and actually this drawer are all set to go, so I just have all of these other ones to do as of right now, but we saw how easy it was to take care of it. If you're interested in getting the plans for this, we now have a SketchUp version of the plan. So we have a PDF version, we have a SketchUp version, and we're actually going to be selling a combo PDF and SketchUp version. All of that information is over at mattsbasementworkshop.com/downloads. And if you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. And you can, of course, send comments to at my website for the show notes for any one of the builds, because you're going to find all of the videos over there and all the blog posts related to the building process. You're going to find that at mattsbasementworkshop.com. And of course, you can leave a comment over at YouTube if that happens to be where you're watching this. So I still got a little bit more work to do here to really, really say that this is wrapped up, but what we're seeing here, that's all there is to building this great dresser. I appreciate all of you coming along and joining me on this. We have another project coming up very, very soon, but I have not completely decided what it's going to be. It's probably going to be something smaller that's not going to take this long to put together, but we definitely had a lot of fun with it. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com. Detailed plans for the 8-drawer tall dresser featured in today's episode are available for sale in the digital download store at mattsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Matt's Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.